for you, how was, what kind of experience was that working with Frank Zappa? Because he's a man, you know, like you told me, he has his, you know, he has his specific things. He's got his career, he's got his ladies, he's got his, you know, etc. How was that for you to go through all those albums with such a character?
Well, you know, I was pretty conservative. So working with Frank was quite a change. You know, it's it took a lot because I didn't really know what this guy was about. You know, and he was when I first started working with him, we were doing the music of King, the Jean-Luc Ponty King Kong album, and I thought that music was very interesting. You know, but when I first began to work with Frank as a mother, when he actually called and asked me to join the band, it was. The music was so diverse, and he started out by doing some old doo wop. Now, I was not really a fan of doo wop, you know, because I was like, I wanted to hear that stuff, you know, not ding dong doo. I was like, oh, what? But see, you know, he broke down that barrier in me, and he says, you don't have to be heavy, and he made me think about that. He said, I don't have to be heavy. To be heavy. And I was like, okay. And he said I needed to lighten up. He taught me to play, that I should play synthesizer, learn to sing, allow my personality to flourish. You know, don't be afraid to be funny on stage. Don't be afraid to experience other things. He and Cannibal Adderley both, in their own way, kind of opened me up to the world of music. You know, so I began to look at it as a white canvas that you could paint any picture on, any color, any texture, any timbre, whatever. You know, and that opened the world to me. I said, wow, you mean I don't have to be just one thing? And that's why I'm as diverse and as crazy as I am, all over the place as I am now.
That's where it came from.
It's amazing. Yeah, and the early part, you were talking about the early part. I don't want to lead you on this, but you know, when I began playing in the church, that's where I first learned how to improvise and play soulful, because I found out the symbiotic relationship between the organist on the other side of the pulpit, the preacher, and then me. And watching how this was orchestrated, you know, when the preacher would get to a certain point, the organ player would start playing, you know, these chords. And I was like, okay. And then he'd play, and then he'd build up, and it'd build up, and the preacher started saying, and the Lord said, and the organ was playing, and it was just, I found out, the preacher would say something, and then the organ player would go, you know, and then some lady would shout, ow! You know, hats will go flying and people will get happy. They're going to, you know, take them out on stretchers.
Oh, club venue, isn't it?
I tell you, it was theater. And I figured, there's a relationship between music and what this guy is saying and what the people are experiencing. So whether they call it the Holy Spirit or the power of the music, whatever you want to call it. Well, at the time it was called soul. or gospel at the time, when that became soul. Mm. So when I heard Ray Charles and David Fathead Newman, Les McCann, those kind of guys, that's what drew me into playing soulfully, because I love that experience of dealing with the audience, the congregation in that case, and all of this kind of coming together in a relationship. And I brought that to Zappa, because see, Frank was into doo-wop and all that kind of stuff, but he had never had anybody to come in there and play that church stuff in the middle of all his weirdness.
So he got a surprise when he met you, really.
Yeah, it was like, he says, I kind of like this, because it was, I could play jazz, but I had that other kind of soulful thing, so I think that's why he liked me in his band. Yeah. That's where I was going with that, because he hadn't had any other keyboard player up to that moment that had that kind of experience musically. Okay, I'll tell you about my new album. It's called Deja Vu. Doesn't mean it's French, but it just means that I've kind of got a retrospective on some music that I used to do in the past and the way it used to be produced. Contrary to Dookie Treats, which is my album before this, Dookie Treats is a little more of a look back at Earth, Wind & Fire, Sly and the Family Stone, Parliament Funkadelic, that kind of music, but a little more on the right. This funk and retrospective on this music is a little more on the left. For example, I have a tribute to Miles Davis, but not from his early 50 or 60 period, from like the Tutu of Manila period, you know, that kind of funky but out kind of jazz funk stuff. I mean, I love that. The Marcus Miller period, so to speak, that's what I try to do. It's a song called Ripple of Time. We have other things on there which are a little more like Sly-like, Sly and the Family Stone, like, because I love that kind of music. And also look back to Brazilian Love Affair. I haven't done any Latin, Brazilian kind of stuff in a long time, so that was a lot of fun to do that. You know, so the album is really, and Deja Vu, the song itself, is kind of a look back at the fusion days of the Mahavishnu Orchestra kind of thing. You know, and so, and the gist of this album is to use a lot of synthesis, a lot of mono synth, you know, not just all polyphonic synth stuff where if you play a chord, you have to do one note at a time, you know, which is reminiscent, people say, of Stevie Wonder, that the way he used to orchestrate his synth stuff. But I used to do the same thing all at the same time. We were all kind of doing that. So there's nice songs on the record. There's some nice grooves on the record, and definitely some nice players. Hubert Laws on flute. We have Nicholas Payton on trumpet. Bob Shepard's playing. Oscar Brashear on trumpet. Man, it's really cool. My young drummer, Ron Bruner, crazy guy. Mike Manson's group I take on the road, actually. It's on the record. Check it out. It's cool. I'm going to go to the hospital.